Hello, everybody. Welcome to my basement. My name is Lynette Kay, and I am the 4-H educator at Cornell Cooperative Extension in Oneida County. One of my favorite parts of my job is when I get to share things that I love with you. And I'm so excited that your teacher invited me to join you today because I get to share something that I absolutely love. And I bet you can tell what that is by what's happening behind me. I love plants.
I love to grow them, plant them, eat them. I love the smell of them, and I have no problem removing the weeds from my garden.
Plants are very important. You might not realize it, but we use them every day. We eat them, we build our houses from the wood that comes from them. That's why it's so important that we learn about them. We need to learn about their parts. We need to learn how to grow and care for them. We need to know how to make more of them. That way we can harvest them to use them. In today's lesson, we're going to discuss flowers. The term flower can be a little bit confusing. We often think of flowers as these big, beautiful blooms, but scientifically speaking, a flower is the reproductive part of a plant. All plants that produce seeds have flowers, but not all flowers are big and beautiful. Grass produces seeds, maple trees produce seeds, pine trees produce seeds, and acorns come off oak trees, and they come from the flower of the oak tree. So all of those plants flower, but I don't remember ever seeing flowers on any of those plants or trees.
At the end of this lesson, you should be able to tell us, what is a flower? What is the role of the flower? Why are some flowers big and beautiful while others barely recognizable? You should be able to identify the plant parts and explain or define each of these vocabulary words. The stigma, the stamen, the pistil, the anther, filament, ovary, ovules, pollen tube, seeds, pollination, fertilization, petal, sepal, and spathe. Let's start with the role of the flower. The flower is the seed-bearing part of the plant consisting of the reproductive organs. Its primary goal is to carry seeds to maturity so that they can be dispersed to start the next generation of that species. Think about the flowers on an apple tree. Once pollinated, the flower fades and eventually turns into a fruit. That fruit then encases the apple seeds within. These seeds are the next generation of apple trees. Many of the fruits that we eat start out as flowers. Think of apples, tomatoes, cucumbers, squash. In fact, the definition of a fruit is that it is a seed-bearing structure that develops from the ovary of a flowering plant. Vegetables come from different parts of the plant. The celery is the stalk, the carrots the root, the lettuce are the leaves. We don't just eat the fruits that result from pollination, we also eat the seeds themselves. Sunflower seeds, beans, corn, many of the grains that we use to make bread and feed to our livestock are the seeds from pollinated flowers. Now that we know what flowers do, let's take a look at why flowers look the way they do. Plants and pollinators have a symbiotic relationship. That means that they need each other. In exchange for pollinating the flowers, pollinators receive sweet nectar, a valuable food source. Some plants have wide flowers that provide a landing pad for pollinating insects like bees and butterflies. Tubular-shaped flowers are a favorite of hummingbirds. When we think of flowers, we think of big, beautiful blooms that smell great. The colors and fragrance are two of the ways that the plant uses to attract pollinators. Flowers are like flags waving in the breeze. They make you pay attention to them. When you find a big flower, what's one of the first things you do? You try to smell it. Have you ever sniffed a flower and ended up with some yellow powder on your nose? The yellow powder is pollen, and you did just exactly what that flower wanted you to do. You got some pollen on your nose. The flower has tricked you into becoming a pollinator. Mother Nature now hopes that you'll take your pollen-covered nose and stick it inside another flower so that fertilization can happen and the next generation of seeds will start to form. Would you ever try to smell a flower that looks like this? Yes, that is a flower. Remember, it's not what a flower looks like that makes it a flower. It's that it has all the reproductive parts. There is nothing on this cattail that looks pretty or smells good. That's because the flowers on this plant don't need you or insects to pollinate them. Instead, they are going to rely on the wind for pollinization. Now that you understand that what makes a flower is not what's on the outside, but what's on the inside, we are going to dissect some daffodils. But before we get started with that, I'd like to mention two things. First of all, I found it very, very helpful to draw a diagram of what I was seeing when I was doing the dissections. The second thing I'd like to mention is please watch this video first and then go back and do the dissection. That should prevent some mistakes from happening. Daffodils come in many different shapes and sizes. Any size will work. However, when it comes to dissection, I think you'll find it much easier if you use a big daffodil than one of those teeny tiny ones. This is what you're going to need for dissection: a daffodil and a pair of scissors. Using your scissors, cut a 2 or 3 inch piece off the end of the stem of your daffodil. You'll notice that the stem is hollow like a straw. Insert your scissors into the straw-like section and slice upwards. Then unravel the stem so that it lays flat. The stem supports the flower. It also contains tubes called the xylem and the phloem. The phloem brings the food down through the stem. The xylem brings the water up. If you look at the image enclosed, you will see the close-up of the xylem and the phloem. In the bud stage, the flower is protected by a strong, thin membrane called the spathe. Use your scissors and cut away the spathe. You'll notice that after you remove the spathe, there is a small, green, slightly round, swollen part just underneath the flower. That is the ovary. We're going to talk about that later. Now we're going to look at the cup and the petal. The cup is the part that looks almost like a trumpet or a horn. If you look inside the cup, you will find the reproductive parts of the flower. We're going to discuss those in a little bit. These are the petals. They're actually modified leaves. Their purpose is to attract pollinators, which is why sometimes they're brightly colored or oddly shaped. This is the sepal. The function of the sepal is to protect the flower bud, and it is often support for the petals when the flower is in bloom. In daffodils, the petals and the sepal are fused together. What I would like you to do now is to remove just the petals, cut all the way around the cup, and leave the sepal. In the next step, we are going to be removing the cup. However, you need to be very careful not to damage the inside portion of the cup because that's the pistil and the stamen, the reproductive parts of the flower. Carefully cut a triangular section out of the cup of the flower, going down to just above the top of the ovary. Your flower should now resemble this. You are now going to remove the rest of the cup. Carefully slice around just above the ovary. The remaining sections are the reproductive parts of the flower, the pistil, the stamen, and the ovary. The pistil is the female section of the flower, while the stamen is the male section of the flower. And if you ever have problems remembering that, think stamen, M-E-N, that's the male part of the flower. Daffodils are considered complete flowers because they have both the male and the female reproductive systems. Some flowers only have male or female. Those are considered incomplete. The female part, the pistil, consists of the style. The style is the tallest part of the reproductive section in the flower. On the top of that is the stigma. The stigma is slightly sticky. That's where the pollen will attach. The pollen will then travel down the pollen tube into the ovary. That's what happens when pollination takes place. This is what the pistil looks like. It's the female section of the flower. We're using the universal female symbol of a cross with a circle above it to designate it as female. In this image, you can see both the pistil and the stamen. The pistil is the taller part. The stamen is the part that has the pollen on it. I want you to very carefully remove the stamen. The stamen has the anther with the pollen, and then there's a long filament that goes down underneath the anther and is attached just above the ovaries. Carefully remove them all around the pistil, but remember, keep the pistil there. We're now going to take a look at the male portion of the flower. We're designating it male using the universal male symbol of a circle with a spear coming out of it. The stamen consists of the anther, and that's where the pollen is, and the filament that is attached to the anther and down by the ovary. Let's take a moment to evaluate what we've learned and seen so far. We're going to talk pollination, fertilization, and seeds. It doesn't matter whether a plant is pollinated by the wind or by an insect or a bird. The action of pollination is the same, and the result is the same. The pollen is going to land on the stigma. It's then going to travel down the style through the pollen tube until it reaches the ovary. Once it reaches the ovary, it is going to fertilize the ovules. Now, fertilization is when the male part of the flower, which remember is the pollen because that came off the anther, is going to fuse with the ovules, which are the female part of the flower. That fusion or fertilization takes place, and the result of that is the formation of seeds. This is a close-up look of the ovules inside the ovary of the flower. Once the flower is fertilized, those ovules will start to swell and turn into seeds. You can now cut into the ovary on your flower and see if you can find the ovules. Now that we've actually finished the dissection, take the time to draw out what you saw and label the parts of the flower appropriately. Now that you've done the dissection and you've seen the different parts of the flower, you understand better why what makes a flower is not what it looks like on the outside, it's that it has the reproductive parts on the inside. Can you identify this flower? This is actually the flower of the maple tree. It's mid-April right now, and the maple trees are in full bloom. Remember, they're pollinated by the wind. Therefore, they don't waste their time creating big, beautiful blooms because they don't need to attract insects. Can you identify the pistils in the stamen? They're there, but they are very tiny.
Pause this video and see if you can answer these questions as well as define and explain the vocabulary words listed below. Regardless of how a plant is pollinated, whether it's done by the birds, the bees, or the wind blowing through the trees, the result and the action is the same. The result is fertilization and seed formation. Thank you for letting me share my love of flowers with you today. I hope by the end of this video you've been able to identify the different parts of the flower as well as understand what those parts do. Remember that seed production is just one way that plants reproduce. If you're interested in learning other ways, please watch my plant propagation video. I'd appreciate it if you'd leave any comments or suggestions to my contact information that's included on this slide. Thanks a lot and have a great day!